Hello and good evening. Thanks for joining us for tonight's edition of Majority Caucus. We are live in Iran, live in Iraq, live in Cuba, live everywhere on online, and also live here from our studios in Accra. We are live with a topic that has many implications to our political discourse. Earlier today, we have witnessed some ruling, if you like, from the Supreme Court regarding the election petition before the justices of the Supreme Court. The outcome was not too good. I do not know for the NDC, but for the lawyer representing the people who wanted to join the case in court, he was not too happy. But we would get him, but not tonight. For tonight, we have one of the lawyers of the NDC legal team. He will be here with us in the studio. He will take us through the issues, what necessitated the petition before the Supreme Court, and whether or not the ruling affects the NDC indirectly. My name is Ali Dawood. You are on Majority Caucus. I have in the studio tonight Mr. Victor Kujoga Adawudu. He's a lawyer by profession and also the spokesperson for the NDC legal team regarding the petition before the Supreme Court currently. Lawyer, thanks for your time.
It's a pleasure always being with you.
Lawyer, it is very obvious that we were not too interested in being bombarded with the proceedings in court every now and then, because we believe the country must be governed regardless of whatever reservation people do have as a result of the fallout from the election 2012. However, I think that the case before the court has taken a new dimension, and we've been told there has been over 300 people wanted to join in. For once, some might say this is absurd, you know.
No, I don't think so. Let me just run quickly from the genesis of the matter so people kind of understand. Mm-hmm. The matter is that the petitioners, for that matter, MPP, decided that they were going to go to court. Now, by the rules of court, you have to file your petition within 21 days. Now, they filed against the president and the electoral commission. NDC came and said that we want to join the action because we are a political party. We sponsored the president, and with the electoral governance, or if you look at democracy in this country, we are part of it. So that's the reason why they joined NDC. That NDC's presence will help to make sure that the matter is completed for once, at once, right? Then on this occasion, the people who came, the applicants who came and wanted to join, are voters, registered voters. What necessitated them coming in was that after the particulars were given to the parties, it came out that 11,916 polling stations are where they are saying that there were alleged irregularities. So if there were irregularities, then the people coming now are saying that we come from those polling stations. Let's say there was some people from Tamale, okay. Some from Adan said that is our polling station. Okay. We voted, we queued, we voted. Everything was transparent. Nobody complained about any irregularity. You're saying that my vote, about 4.5 million votes, which my vote is included, should be annulled. So it was on that basis, after the fact, after they have given the particulars, that they said, okay, I'll come in. I want to join so that I can protect my vote, because Article 42 confers that right on me. It's fundamental to vote. Now, if the petitioner is saying that annul my vote or cancel it, my vote should not count, then they were saying no. So that's the basis, the main basis why the applicants came. So it's just like as the MPP, their surrogates will say, let my vote count. Let my vote count. If the vote is to count, right, then these people also chose the way, the very civil and decorous way, that let's come to court and ask that the court should protect our interest. So that is the basis upon which they came to court. Now let me come to the ruling of the court. Because of the number, it was about 327 applicants who came. And when they came to court, the court saw the number, and you know, unfortunately, because of the security, the people were coming. The security people did not allow them to even come into the yard because they said no. So the court asked that they should go and bring them. But when the lawyer went, he said the people were frustrated, so they had to leave because the security said they will not allow them. Then the court said, okay, we will allow you that you do it in a representative capacity. In American parlance, they say class action. Let's say one or two people represent all of them. So their lawyer moved. And when he moved, he said that looking at the electoral processes, if you go through, we have three key stakeholders. We have electoral commission, we have the candidates, right? And we have the voter.
Okay.
These are the three key people. So if you remove one from them, then there is a problem. Okay. So that is why these people are coming in as a voter. They want their vote. But the court said, looking at the processes, they think that the parties in the case, their interests will be protected. Because anything they say, and looking at it, that a constitutional matter is a constitutional matter, anything that they say even would affect they themselves, the judges. Right? So the court went on and said that, yes, we recognize that you have a right, you have to come and vote. However, if we allow you to come, then that means all Ghanaians who registered as voters and citizens would want to come.
That's the floodgate argument.
No, we'll come and join. Okay. So because we recognize this, your right, you can assist any of the parties and come as a witness.
Okay.
So that means the courts have agreed that yes, you are a stakeholder in the electoral process. However, because we want to manage this case, you can come as a witness for any of the parties.
So technically, their case was not thrown out.
No, not that it was thrown out.
It was submerged.
That the parties over there can take charge of their interest, will protect their interest. It's just like, you see, let me give you one of the scenarios, the case of Apalu. There's a case we've been quoting, Apalu,
famous Apalu.
You see, before 2000 election, when they registered people, Electoral Commission said, if you don't have the photo ID card, if you don't have your picture on it, you will not vote. It was only Apalu who went to court as an individual and said that at the time they were doing it, I wasn't there, but I have an ID card without a photo, so I should be allowed to vote.
Okay.
One person, what he went to court to do, allow everybody, the whole electoral processes were changed and everybody voted. So it is not like,
but the idea that these people wanted to join in, and knowing clearly that the NDC has joined, we have the president also there as one of the respondents, that indeed these two parties would, in a way, fight for their interest, and that there's not going to be anything significantly different apart from wanting to delay the process in court.
I don't buy that argument.
When I mean, somebody, 300, that there are just too many? 300?
No. The reason why, I gave you a scenario here that if you look at the electoral processes, we have electoral commission.
Okay.
Who is there? If voters don't vote, will there be any vote being cast? So voters are necessary parties to this issue. The candidates or the party are necessary. So there are three legs in this matter.
Okay.
Right? The two are there. And now the third one is coming as a voter. But the court says, yes, we recognize that you're right. But because we want to manage this case, you can be a witness. Are you getting it? It's an issue of when we are talking about delay, and when somebody's talking about justice, I want my right, because this is the only opportunity that the rich and the poor have the same right.
But justice delayed. Justice delayed is indeed.
That is why
justice
court,
that has been denied.
Yes, that's why the court took cognizance of the fact that yes, we appreciate, we know that you have that right. However, we think that if you have anything, you can come as a witness under these parties, the parties before the court.
But their lawyer, Senano, wasn't too pleased with this ruling. He thought that the court was dictating as to who should legally represent his client. The idea that you should come and assist, you know, the already parties who are part of the process, he thinks it's absurd. That his client should have the freedom, should have that right to choose anybody as their representative in court.
I understand the sentiments by which my learned colleague, Kobla Senanu, because Kobla Senanu, his point was that almost all the provisions on election revolves around a voter. It revolves around electoral commission. Mm-hmm. It revolves around the political party. Mm-hmm. So if you see the political party as a necessary party and interested, then why wouldn't you see the voter as a necessary party to that matter, right? Mm-hmm. Now, so he thinks that the voter has been shortchanged. Mm. You could, for him, he thinks that even if you admitted only one person to join, to represent
the rest of them,
mm-hmm. would have been something that you have recognized that right and it has to be protected. But, you know, subsuming that under that of the parties, I get it. Mm-hmm. It's like another gray area. It has its own issue. But because this is a constitutional issue,
okay,
I think that is why, because the courts is of a policy that, listen, election is more like a lethal weapon. And anything can inflame passions. So it is better we move quickly and make sure we can manage this. I think that is the essence.
Let me ask you this. Are you sure, or in what way has this ruling affected the substantive matter before the court? I mean, is there any you know, change that we are likely to see as a result of this ruling?
No. I don't think it will affect. The where I can say that it might affect will be our constitutional law.
Okay.
One day, because the court has gone ahead with constitution to reaffirm the right of the voter in Article 42. Uh-huh. So the right of the voter has been reaffirmed that it is fundamental and it has been recognized. Like it has, the courts have consistently said. So the right of the voter cannot be toyed with. But with the substantive matter, what happened also in court today is that the petitioners came with application for direction. What we talk about direction is that when you file, you exchange papers, you finish, all pleadings are closed. Pleadings just means that what I'm saying, you put your defense. When you put the defense, I'll reply and say, what you are saying here is not correct. It's like this. Okay. Then when we finish, we come to court. Then we say, oh, okay, this, looking at what we have put on paper, these are the issues that we want the court to look into and determine. Right? But there are several ways of doing it at the High Court. There's no uniform procedure when it comes to that. It's not all the High Courts that you have to do that. So when they did that, then the lawyer for NDC, Samuel Kojo, said that the process by which they have come with the application of direction is wrong.
How so?
Yes, it was wrong. So he filed an objection to that process.
Okay.
And he made a very important, solid argument that looking at it, the rules have shown what has to be done. That after filing all those papers, you come to court, the court will decide what to run. You don't set the agenda for the court. Okay. So the process by which they had come was wrong. So the court said, okay, looking at it, we don't want to delay the speed because of expedition. We would deem that what they have filed is a memorandum of issues. Because when it comes to petition and other things, you don't file application or direction. Okay. You do memorandum of issues. That's where you put your issues together and say that the court should look at these issues. So he was given the opportunity that he should file his issues. Now, it was at that stage. So in principle, his objection was upheld. You understand? Yes, but they overruled and said that, okay, we will deem it as this, because the equity says what ought to be done. If it is done, that's so. So that's, then they said lawyers also should, you know, be officers of the court.
Absolutely.
We try to find out how we can help the court to come to an amicable resolution of matters. So with all the issues that have been found, it's almost about 30 issues plus. So all the lawyers, the parties should sit down, look at it, narrow it down.
Okay.
Look at which issues the two parties or everybody agrees on, then we bring it to court. If we are not able to do that within 7 days, then we have to inform the registrar. Then when we inform the registrar will write to the court. Then they will give a date. We will go to the court and they will give direction as to how the case would go, as to which issues they want to determine that.
To be clear, the substantive matter has not been dealt with
at all. Nothing has been done with until we go and the court gives us that direction.
Okay.
Then the court will say that I'm going to fix this day. On this day, you can start your case, the petitioners. Okay, bring your witnesses and let's start the case. So the court will tell you how they will go. The court can decide that we will do it daily or how they want the case, they would manage the case. It is the court that manages the case. So the substantive matter, we've not started anything on that.
How long do we anticipate that this trial will take? I mean, looking at so many preliminary issues that have been raised so far, the matter and question itself has not been dealt with. How long?
Because, you see,
3 more months or 2 more months?
Oh, I cannot tell, but you see, we cannot short circuit the process.
Okay.
It is a court that will determine how it will manage the cases. We have 26,002 polling stations. And they are challenging almost half of it, 11,000. So it will be the witnesses that would come. I understand people say that, oh, we don't need everybody to come. You cannot just look at the person, the court, and say that, yes, what you are saying is relevant, I won't take it. Maybe until he gets into the box, all that he says, you say, oh, it is the same as Kofi Mensah said. So it's relevant, but I won't take it. Because Kofi Mensah makes the same point. So until you listen to the person, you cannot just look at him and say that, no, you cannot come. Or the courts can also give direction that, okay, we want to know the summary of the evidence, what the person is coming to say. Even that, if you put that, the other parties will cross-examine to find the credibility of the person, to find the veracity of what he's saying. So it's I will wait to see how, but I don't see how.
I know the practice exists, for instance, in the state where you deposed, and both councils meet, you depose each other's witnesses before you even get to the court. So in that case, you have time to screen what will be relevant and what will not before you appear.
Yeah, it is part of our rules in the CI40, part of our rules that you can depose by affidavit writing. But you see, if that the person is not available to be cross-examined on what he or she is saying, they will expunge that piece of evidence. Because you just don't write anything and put it there. Because you need to cross-examine the person on what he's saying.
Absolutely. Let me take you back to this application for joinder. Some have said that apart from it being a deliberate ploy, but the fact that these people are the NDC, I think the misconception in the public is that, oh, NDC people want to join, 300 people want to join. Is it really NDC, full soldiers?
You see, no.
Constituency executives?
No, you see, the law will avail itself to the one who is vigilant, equity, right? Law will avail itself to the person who is vigilant but not lazy. If you see that something is affecting you, going to affect you, They were vigilant about their vote. So when the attention was drawn, there's nothing on the face of the application they brought that we are members of NDC and we are coming to court.
Their court seemed to benefit the NDC.
It benefits everybody. Or it's just a mere coincidence. They are saying that we are registered voters. When you are saying that the vote should be annulled, we voted at that place. So if I went through the process and my vote, my ballot was stamped as valid, nothing happened to it. And you are saying that the vote from that vote I cast should be annulled. They are coming and say that no, we don't think that that vote should be annulled. Okay. Right? Mm-hmm. They cut across. Even when people come and they say they want to join, the petitioners are saying that 4.5 million votes should be annulled. And the same petitioners are saying that 3.1 something should be taken from President Mahama's vote. 1.5 should be taken from Nana Akufo-Addo's vote. So how do you know? Even do you know that the people who came, the people who are coming, the applicants who voted, their voting was by secret ballot.
Yeah.
So how do you know that they voted for NDC and say, oh, the people who are coming are NDC?
They say the benefit. Their course
it's because,
of action
you see, seems to because when they come,
go for the NDC.
They have any testimony which will help the court. That is why the NDC did not even oppose.
Okay.
Electoral Commission did not oppose. Are you getting it? Mm. That because if they have anything, any evidence, it will help the court.
Okay.
Are you getting it? They came as voters. Because even Article 2 of the Constitution says that if you think that any of the provision is being violated, right? You can go to court and say this provision is going to be violated or my right is going to be violated. I think it's on this basis that they came to court. Are you getting it? That is it. And I think in court also, one of the things that I think as lawyers, we are in court, we need to rise above the emotions. And there was a scene which was nasty.
Crying.
No. I think the counsel, the lead counsel for the petitioners, Addison. Made some derogatory remarks about Koblasen Anu, which the court did not take kindly.
Can you share with our viewers what
the
exactly that he said?
You know, after Mr. Koblasen Anu made his submission, he was to respond. And he just said that, did he move his application? I didn't hear a word of what he is saying. I don't even understand it. Which is derogatory, to denigrate or downgrade the lawyer. He's a senior lawyer, which the court did not take lightly. And the court told him they have heard what he said.
Okay.
But at the end of the day, Justice Doche, he said that he was distressed when counsel was making such comments. And he also says that some of these comments we make are things that will inflame passions.
Yeah.
And there are people, but it was not right that it should be done. We should do it in civility. We should be decorous. I think it is something that the fact that we are in a legal battle does not mean we are enemies and you speak anyhow to anybody. It's not because of politics. You run down any person.
But I will say I'm personally shocked that a lawyer of his, caliber would engage in such frivolity and pettiness.
It's been going on.
Oh, this is not the first time.
Yes, but I think the court has made its point clearly that it does not augur well for
especially for a senior lawyer
us. So I think that it's something that everybody we have to learn lesson that listen, if you have a case, we don't put our emotion. We are trained not to put our emotion.
They need to be
as if you want to set personal scores for your client.
That is not a proper.
You know, clients will come to you and they think that, oh, this lawyer, this case, you have to fight for me and set a personal score.
No,
lawyers are not trained to do
it's,
that.
Clearly, the court is a serious for ventilating your concern and seeking redress. Stay with me. Majority Caucus returns right after this. Hello, and thanks for staying with us. If you're just joining in, We are live from our studios here in Accra. This is Majority Caucus. Like I indicated earlier, we do apologize sincerely for the late start of the program. We had some one or two things that we needed to put together. Sincerely apologize for that. And we are also still live in Basra, Iraq, Iran, Kenya, Cuba, South Africa, everywhere on www.multitvworld.com. We are also live on your Digibox. Council, I'm sure that for most of our viewers, of course, you need accreditation before you'll be allowed in. And to that extent, we are not privy to the argument from both councils for and against. And perhaps you might want to share, you know, with us what were the arguments advanced regarding this joiner petition application for joiner, sorry, over the 300 people who wanted to join earlier.
I think it was an interesting argument that was made.
Okay.
Principally, the factors for which joiner should be considered will be to see whether you are a necessary party, you are interested in the matter, and your presence in the matter will bring to the final and effectual determination of the matter. Now, Mr. Senanu argued on behalf of all the applicants because the court said that we cannot listen to all the lawyers.
Okay.
Because Mr. Senanu filed some of the applications. Mr. Stephen Ahon also filed some, and Eric Atieku also filed some. So the court agreed that it should be done in a representative capacity. So they elected Mr. Senanu to speak on their behalf. I think what the argument he made was that, first one, that they are in court because they are necessary parties, they are interested in the matter as voters. Now, it has come to their notice that their votes will have to be annulled because looking at the polling station that has been put in there, these applicants are coming and say that, look, do not annul our vote.
Because it affects them directly.
It affects us directly. So why will you annul my vote? Then he went on and said that even if you look at Article 42, which grants that right, Article 55 also talks about participating and decision-making in electoral process. And the voter is key over there. So he talked about that and says, these are people who actually cast their vote. It is not the party that go. We go back to the voters every 4 years to go and ask them to cast their vote. So they are the kingmakers.
Indeed.
And every 4 years, we will go back to them. So they will decide who to give their vote to and make who becomes the president. So he made that argument. And you know, he's a very religious man. And he talked about the pot, the potter, and the clay. It's just like biblical, the potter. You get the potter makes the pot. So he likened it that the parties are the pot and the potter. Now the voters are the clay. So if you want
the key ingredient.
So if the potter and they are in dispute and others, then you should ask the clay. So he thinks that voters as a clay should be.
That's an interesting analogy.
It's an interesting analogy he made. And I think that, so he said it's a constitutional matter. And then the court also asked that. So does he want all people who register as voters should join? He said, no, these are particular polling stations that have been affected. So people coming, they are coming from that place. And this is the point that he made, that every 4 years, all the parties, all the candidates will go back and ask. So if you don't put the voter in, if you don't listen to him now, then you go back again. That means that if you make any decision that will affect them, how do you go back to them? That was his argument.
Okay.
And so when he made that argument, the opposition to his argument was that if they allow
The council for Nana Akufo-Addo.
The council for Nana Akufo-Addo. They said it will open a floodgate, and he replied that floodgate for everybody to come in. It's not going to be everybody. It's only affected person, and that is why the court, in its own wisdom, says that it should be done in representative capacity. And he make a solid argument that equity aids the vigilant. So these voters were vigilant. They are not coming at the time that you have made decision before they come. Then the opposition, as they were, Mr. Addison made his argument. He said that all rights are not equal. The petition had been given 21 days. And after months, these people are now coming. Then he said that looking at that, it should be an equal treatment.
But before you go on, okay, you let me just listen to that.
Now, so he made his argument and said that the first respondent, that is the president and NDC, they are better placed to cater for their interests or protect their interests. And he said he didn't think the applicants were a necessary party, and the court will not be disabled to determine the matter if their presence, they are not present. So that's the gist of what he said. And then he said the application was in bad faith and it was intended to delay the trial. So,
let me ask this for the main respondent. Obviously, if you have not been mentioned as the main respondent, then the time allowed certainly is going to exceed the 21 days.
Definitely.
Because you are not the main respondent. Yeah, so you have the laxity or you have the luxury of time, if you like, to join in.
Yeah, I think that argument, when he made the argument, the court, I think one of the judges asked him and said that, I think that the argument you were making was inconsistent and incoherent. Because if you are talking about equality and the same right, then the argument were incoherent or inconsistent. Because what he was saying, that at the end of the day, in one vein, it supports what the applicant says, in another vein, it was against. So the court drew his attention to that. So these were the arguments that were made.
Okay.
Now, when it comes to the objection, when the NDC lawyer stood up the objection, he says that the court makes rules. Now, if it makes rules and you don't follow that rule and you come, because the court will say that if you want any remedy or you want any relief, come by this procedure, process. If you come by another process, in as much as they can say, okay, it's the substance we are looking at, it's not the form, it is not always you can come, then it is not right.
Okay.
You have to go and adopt the procedure the court rule says you should come. And by coming by application of direction, it was not right.
Okay.
So he argued and gave a judgment, a recent judgment that has been reported in 2011 by the same court, and even some of the panel members who gave that is the decision they said. Looking at it,
if he had succeeded the application for direction, what would have been the fallout?
No, he was asking that it should be struck out.
Okay.
So when it is struck out, then the court would give direction now as to how it should be taken.
Okay.
But in principle, the court said, yes, we recognize that they don't have to come by application of direction. They have to come by memorandum of issues. So we would deem what they have filed as memorandum
of issues.
Of issues. So in principle,
they should be grateful to the court.
Yeah, so in principle, because of the expedition time constraints, they want everything to go quickly. That's why.
Let me draw your attention to matters outside our jurisdiction here in Ghana. Elsewhere in Kenya, I'm sure there's another election petition before the court. But something significantly different from what Nana Akufo-Addo and the MPP are doing, Raila Odinga rather urges supporters not to take to the street, because he doesn't believe that those atrocities and act of vigilante would inure to the benefit of his cause in the court. Is there any lesson we want to learn from there?
Definitely. That is where sometimes I would want to commend the applicants who came to court, that they will not want to take to the street and say that they want my vote to be annulled. If anybody annuls my vote in Ghana, there will be war.
Okay.
But they chose a very civil forum and says that there is rule of law. Let's go there and talk about our vote. Listen, Kenya, because what they have gone through, it was a very small issue that started. And, you know, at the end of the day, the number of people who were killed, You see your own brother, they were using machete and others on people. It tells you that when it comes to politics, religion, people do not reason. They do not allow reason to prevail. Mm-hmm. And anything that would trigger or spark it off would go. So that is good. You see that we are maturing. Democracy mm-hmm. is taking place. Reasoning is taking place. And I think I will commend him. Yeah, it is better we go to court. Yes, that is why I always say that it is good. It's not we go and stand somewhere and make noise and say anything threatening to throw bombs.
Call the president
and
names.
The bomb doesn't know who is NDC or NPP. It is people who do not have meaning and purpose in life. They don't have that. They would go and make those reckless comments.
Finally.
Yes, because if they had...
Sorry to butt in, I'm running out of time. The MP for Menchia,
Matthew
Opoku-Prempeh, has made some comment reported in the newspapers, I don't remember specifically, that the fact that the court is entertaining such application for joinder could be a recipe for lawlessness in the country.
I don't think he understands the process. And you see,
and he's a member of parliament.
No, he doesn't. For the MPP. Yes, he's a medical doctor. He doesn't understand the process, the legal.
You mean he doesn't appreciate the law?
He doesn't appreciate the law. The law is different from sociological things that you can talk about. Sometimes when you go, that's why you go to law school first year. You see, this is common sense, sociological issues. Mm-hmm. Then you don't see, no, the law has a different dynamics. And I won't fault him because maybe he doesn't really appreciate and understand it like that.
But as a member of parliament, he legislates laws. He should be well grounded to be making responsible comment, don't you think?
They learn and they ask and they are educated on it. Mm-hmm. I think it's always a learning curve always. Mm-hmm. So if it's a learning curve, we should also make a point to always learn. If you don't understand something, get educated on it. Because it cannot be a form of lawlessness. Mm-hmm. When people decide to take to the street and other things, do you know what will happen in this country? Our children, our wives, even the poor ones in the villages, what will happen? This is a very peaceful country. We are blessed. I believe that the court will do what it's expected. It's a public function they are performing. We pay them by our taxes, consolidated fund, we pay them from it. So they will not also sit there and do anything reckless. I don't think any judge with the modicum of respect and understanding would want to do anything to leave for posterity to judge him. I don't know. No.
Okay. Thank you very much for coming through. I know you are busy, man.
Ali, it's a pleasure.
And we end the discussion on this note, but make a date with me on Tuesday. Till then, be good and stay blessed. Thanks for joining. Bye-bye.